A UK tour done in one single day. They started at Wembley 12 noon, it's now 10 past 11 at night. They are status quo.
On the 21st of September 1991, status quo achieved a milestone in lunacy when they successfully completed four concerts in a single day in cities across the UK. You have had the incredible good sense to purchase a complete record of the day in the form of the Rock Till You Drop video cassette. Now, if you've already watched the programme, you'll know that both the day itself and the film are towering examples of the relaxed professionalism which status quo bring to everything they do. But was it all as easy as it looks?
There's just a set amount of wild ideas flying around in the atmosphere. And David Walker acts like a magnet to several of the wildest. And this idea just hit him one day.
It all came into my head. And I remember I woke up in the middle of the night. And I woke my wife up, kidding me. I said, I've got this ridiculous idea.
He said, I've got a great idea for the next album. I've got a whole plot, you know. I said, yeah, good. He said, McCauley album Rock Till You Drop. So both me and Rick went.
He phones you up, right?
This is Walker.
Yeah. This is only can only be Walker. Yeah. I've got an idea. I've got a great idea. Oh, no. Oh. One of his ideas, you know.
I said, this Rock Till You Drop. I said, what we do is we fly all over the country and we do all these gigs on the same day. And she said, that's your idea, is it? What did you wake me for?
Rock Till You Drop began officially on the 23rd of July at North Holt Aerodrome. This was when the world's media were to be officially made aware of the band's intention to create their ridiculous record. Intrepid heroes would arrive in Spitfires to emphasize whatever it was they felt the need to emphasize.
Achieved worldwide sales of over 100 million units. They've had 42 hit singles in Britain, over half of which have entered the top 10. They've made over 100 appearances on Top of the Pops, more than any other band. This band has been together for 25 years. This band is Status Quo.
The incredibly handsome, pathetically underpaid and hugely talented Chris Tarrant was engaged to inform the assembled gentlemen of the press about the forthcoming Quo extravaganza and spellbind them with his incisive wit and designer stubble. Who wrote this crap?
Well, I have to explain the itinerary because none of the band are actually very good at geography. Marvellous Pictures there, they've hardly changed at all over the years, have they? The whole thing has been sponsored by Britannia. Thanks very much. Basically, thanks very much to John Nelligan and Gerald Good, who I know here today. They put on all the money, but they just thought it was just such a ridiculous idea that only a band like this could actually come up with, or certainly a management like this could come up with. It's come as a bit of a surprise to the boys. All proceeds on the day from the box offices will be presented to charity. The whole thing starts at 12 noon on the dot on Saturday, September the 21st. It starts with two songs, ideally different, live on Going Live, in front of His Serene Highness Philip Schofield, and Norris McWhirter. Apart from everything else on this this day of days, September the 21st, basically, first time ever, they should get themselves in the Guinness Book of Records. Please welcome Norris McWhirter to explain how it all works. Norris! So, you need to walk from there, I'm buggered. Hello, Norris. Just, so, you're adjudicating at the BBC and when they leave at 12 o'clock?
Start and the finish with a stopwatch.
You're not going to Glasgow and...
No, I'm going to watch them on the TV.
Presumably there's nothing like this, is there? I mean, there's no similar record.
This is an inaugural record. There's never been one like this. This is gigs per hour. So it's GPH instead of MPH.
I never thought I'd hear you say the word gigs, Norris. I don't know why. You're a gigs kind of a chap. I mean, and will it... I mean, if they do it, because obviously, I mean... Presumably they'll get through the whole thing. It isn't extraordinary though, they'll get there somehow. What, when will it go in the Guinness Book of Records?
Well, it'll go in the 1993 edition.
Okay, now, just... presumably you're also going to... I mean, you're covering it on telly on Going Live on the Saturday, but then are you going to do... I feel a tenuous plug for Record Breakers coming on, Norris.
Yes, Record Breakers are going to be right in there. And we're in our 20th year, so we're feeling a bit young compared with Quo in their 26th year.
Everybody feels young compared with Crow. That's what's great about meeting them. So Record Breakers is back, and you're actually going to carry some of the stuff from the Saturday on the first show of the new series.
We are indeed, yes. And we're looking forward to that with Cheryl Baker interviewing them, and it'll be a great addition to our show for the next generation of Crow fans.
Cheryl Baker interviews Francis Rossi.
Yes, that's right.
It's a bit of a Mensa meeting.
I wore a jacket in case it's chilly.
Yeah.
Blimey. So tell us about the record tonight.
Go on, Rick, tell them.
We've got to... as far as I know... Go on, Rick.
Sorry, she was touching my leg. What do you want me to say?
To everyone's surprise, especially the bands, they rounded off the afternoon with a performance of Rocking All Over the World. Beautiful, beautiful love song.
We'll be right back.
As the stage and lights were already set up, the boys, it calls them here, decided to save a few quid by recording a video for the album's first single, Can't Give You More. Tour, their equipment travels ahead of them in huge articulated lorries. After each gig, the equipment is broken down straight away and the trucks trundle through the night to the next venue. Once there, they put everything together in time for the band to test the equipment before the show. Now, this is called a sound check and it usually takes place around 4 o'clock in the afternoon. For Rock Till You Drop, things had to be rather different. The band walks straight on stage at each venue with no time whatsoever to check anything, which makes for an unusual set of problems. For a start, the band had to hire 4 complete sets of equipment, including musical instruments. 4 identical sound systems and 4 identical lighting rigs had to be set up specially. Everything at each venue had to be duplicated precisely so that the band could just walk on and play.
What this is, a brilliant idea, and basically I've got a lighting rig that's scaled down to 4:1. I've got it completely to myself. I've got the desk I need, I've got the lighting rig I need. What I haven't got is backline roadies going, can we have light on stage? Yeah. I haven't got a band making awful noises that I can't say, can you stop and go back 4 bars, because I've got it all on cassette. Yeah. And I can work down here quickly, in my own time, at my own pace, and get a show in the desk without any distractions at all. Quo don't need a light show. They're a live band. People come to see the band, so you brief us to light the band. They don't care so much in terms of what it looks like as long as it looks right, as long as it's bright and we can see the band the whole time. The problem with this is I've got 4 different shows. I know the shows, that's not a problem for me, but I've got to teach those shows to 4 other people. So here's great, I can come in one day, I can focus the rig and program in the shows that I want to see and then spend a day each with operators teaching them the show. All I need, to be honest, is a cassette and an empty room with a lighting rig. I don't really need the band there. It's only if there's any major changes or any new numbers I actually need to see the band, to be perfectly honest. The rest of the time I only need to see them when Rick goes, Pat, I need yellow in this number. I've never ever seen Francis behind the lighting desk, you know. Hey, Pat, turn them on. All you need is a white light, isn't it? Which, the bottom line is actually true. I could just throw up white light on this band and the fans would still think it was great.
Musicians have a very personal relationship with their instruments, and to play on gear which lacks familiarity makes things just that bit harder.
The oldest one of the lot, 1957. Well, that's where originally you put the string in the back, but this one here, it's a couple of stories. I've asked Francis about them, but some people think it's when he passes the guitar, he puts his thumb in it and passes it over to you, but it could be like, I don't know, maybe it could have been Julian Knight's on a bit of furniture, had his guitar underneath it and it's gone straight through it, I've never realised. It's a trademark, about, like G&L and Fender started making them for him.
With holes in?
With holes in, yeah. And they think it's something to do with acoustics. That's where Rick, like, sort of, as he's like power chording away, that's from like, say, 25 years of like, sort of this constantly, this part of his hand, just rubbing it away. There's one pet name. I mean, like, sort of, I suppose if he like, sort of loved it that much, he'd write a song about it, like about his cars, but he hasn't written one about his guitars yet.
Out now to Ruislip Airport, here about 12:30. Although setting up 4 gigs on the same day does have extra problems, essentially it's familiar ground for Status Quo. who've always played live gigs. The unknown factor was the amazing transport schedule. Now, those of you who'd regularly travel to work or to school or to the shops or even to the nearest public lavatory will know just how many things can and do go wrong on what should be the simplest journey. What possible chance do these blokes have of getting from London to Sheffield to Glasgow to Birmingham and back to London in a single afternoon while still finding time to play 4 hours of rock and roll? If this record was to be achieved, this was the problem they had to somehow crack. Planes and helicopters may be fast, but how often do they take off when they're supposed to? What about the weather? What about the queue at the duty-free shop?
I'm Jed Hughes of Starflight Aviation, and we're the people that have been called in to work out this mammoth problem of today. A lot of people don't realise how big it is, but to give you some sort of illustration, I suppose the best way I can say that Live Aid in 1985, which we did, we had about 240 movements. The biggest concert in Britain ever that was done last year was Nebworth, which of course Quo were involved there again. And on Nebworth, we had, I think it was about 270 movements. It was probably the biggest in any music event in Britain of all time. And today, we've got 105 movements. We've got 10 aircraft involved, we've got helicopters obviously doing connections, fixed-wing aircraft, transferring people, and of course sound people ahead of them as well. So the whole thing is quite complex. So far of the day, this time of the day, it's looking very good, and we hope the whole thing continues. The one thing that's been fortunate to us is up above, we've got reasonable weather, we're looking pretty good from now on.
Assuming that the band could somehow get round all this outrageous musical assault course, how could we all observe the madness unless the cameras could stay with them? This problem fell to another motley collection of lunatics employed by PolyGram Video International. Don't laugh. First of all, we needed a full outside broadcast unit at each venue. These had to be booked months in advance, as most facilities are busy with sport on a Saturday. Also required were four mobile recording studios. This covers the concerts, but again, the difficult part was the travelling. We had to have a camera and a sound man in every car, bus, plane and helicopter. Also, we needed motorbikes to cover road travel, helicopters to shoot air-to-air stuff, more cameras to shoot takeoffs and landings, all in all an incredibly complex production. The concert footage was shot on six cameras. The pictures from these were fed into the outside broadcast truck, where the best shots could be selected to be recorded onto a videotape. And in addition, some of the cameras were recorded separately so that some re-editing could take place afterwards. The four different show directors each decided where to place their cameras and how to cut between them. The sound was recorded on 24-track tape for the boffins amongst you, separating out each instrument in turn. This allows the repair of any technical faults before the sound is mixed into stereo and then rejoined to the pictures. All right, following so far? No, nor me. The real problem with shooting concerts is keeping the sound in sync with the music. Now, this is done by using an EBU25 frame timecode reference to PAL video syncs. This is produced by a timecode generator locked to a PAL sync pulse generator. Interestingly enough, this signal effectively numbers each frame of video using an hours, minutes, seconds frame number. The signal is fed to the timecode track on the VT master out to track 24, you know, on the multitrack, which should have the noise reduction switched out as this can corrupt the code. In this way, the audio and video signals can at all times be kept in sync using a dedicated synchronizer. Any other clocks inherent in the format, such as PAL video and digital word clocks, should be referenced to the EBU code to prevent problems cropping up during post-production. It's
why do people who understand things like this always talk in these sort of voices? I don't know.
All the tapes were returned to London the day after the event, and every single piece of footage was examined carefully so that construction of the various programmes could begin. First away was the BBC Record Breakers programme, which went out less than a week after the event. Following that was a documentary on Channel 4 called Rock Till You Drop, rather catchily, and finally the complete record of the day that you so wisely purchased. The event and the film were hard work and great fun for everybody involved, but in the end it was worthwhile because of the band themselves and because of their beautiful, beautiful music. Never in the whole history of popular music have five more talented people played more inspired music for such a long period. And can I have my check now, please?
For Christ's sake, of course they're not doing an encore. The guys have been going for nearly 12 hours. They are wrecked.
And knowing what you know now, would you have agreed to do this in the first place?
In a word? No, we wouldn't. Right. Yeah, we wouldn't. We actually thought it would be easier than this.
You did,
we thought it would be easier than that.